kind of shy about that as a movement, right? Like, we don't, we just want to win this argument, or, oh, we just want to make this point, or we just want to make a good impression on someone, and we kind of fall short of what the real objective is in achieving a free society and growing a movement. And we have to be honest about what we are doing with other people. We are introducing and asking them to embrace a totally different worldview. That's winning converts. You know, we talk about this as a political movement. And of course, here at the LNC, it's like, oh yeah, this is the political side. Even here, it's really cool to feel. This is not like a normal political convention. Because this isn't a political movement. It's an anti-political movement. It's a philosophy movement, an ethics movement, a morals movement, right? I mean, there's something deeper than, well, I want statism to taste like this, right? Red or blue, whatever. So winning converts, like we because of that, this movement, I don't know if you've noticed, I would hope, but it actually acts, it behaves a lot more like a religious movement. Yeah? Okay. Kind of nice to hear that when you're like, I knew something was different about this place. Right? But then, you know, you can have a political movement and a religious movement. I don't know, maybe you put it the other way around. Religious movement is higher than political movement. I don't know. The Catholic Church asks for 10%, the state asks for 50%, so right. But when you're talking about winning converts, that's an important metric of success. How many people, it's not like, did I share the message with you? Did I tell you why I'm a libertarian? You know, did I get you, oh yeah, I agree with you on this, that, and the other. No, I want, and I, this is something that I've come to as a conclusion in my activism after, 8.5 years.
That's nothing.
Well, if you made it that long without burning out, you probably got a long career as an activist ahead of you. And actually, that's one of the subjects we're going to come back to. But winning converts is ground that you gain that can't be taken back. The frustration that I had, I mean, so I started my activism with the Iraq Veterans Against the War. And y'all know the interaction with Obama and the anti-war movement, and where did the anti-war left go? Well, you fight issue by issue, it's like fighting inch by inch while they take a mile behind your back and laugh at you. But if you share the message with someone, and it's a gift, and this is how it's different from a religious movement. I mean, it's great to acknowledge the similarity, right? But we're not asking people to embrace our superstition. We're asking people to apply their own reason and logic in a way that we have that has enriched our lives. It gives us a clearer worldview that empowers us to live better. And you can tell. Like, and this is the thing, here, you know, when we want to be inclusive, you know, it doesn't matter if you're not really a libertarian. If you want to call yourselves that, start coming in our direction, cool. Sign our forms, come to our meetings, we'll convert you later. Like, you know, we'll get there. But it's important to recognize that there is something different. And you can tell, and there are people here who get it, and people here, this event, who don't. That's cool, totally welcome. You want to put the label on you? Want to support that, absolutely. But you guys know that there's a distinct corner that you turn in becoming a libertarian and thinking for yourself and having a worldview that is based on your own reason and evidence, right? So when you share that with someone, you've freed a mind. You've elevated someone. You've raised them up to a higher state of living. And you can tell if they're a convert or not. And it doesn't mean they have to agree with you on everything or you know, subscribe to your particular vision, but you can tell when someone has done that. So that being said, the next one was making the state obsolete. And this is fun. This is something, I mean, you could argue that the state has always been obsolete, right? But specifically today, in the way that we see the state achieving actual things that aren't just like killing people and hurting people, right? Stealing stuff, that there are specific ways that are very exciting right now with technology that we are rendering the state obsolete. Apps like Peacekeeper and Cell 411. So, hey, you don't have to call the cops. You can press a button that alerts all your neighbors, right? You know, we don't have to rely on a welfare state when we can come together with the internet to connect better in our communities. We're less likely to make war overseas. I mean, making war obsolete, I mean, it's kind of When was that ever a productive idea, right? We're going to kill a bunch of people and break a lot of stuff? Yeah. But we can.
Rockefeller.
Well, right. It's productive for the racketeers and profiteers, of course. So where that goes in terms of technology and looking forward is very important, but I'm not any kind of expert in this. You know, I get to see it happening and just geek out and appreciate that. And for those of you who consider yourselves entrepreneurs, and I think when you wake up, have you guys noticed that in our movement, there are a lot of entrepreneurs?
Yep.
Not necessarily successful tech billionaires. I mean, it'd be nice if we had some more sponsors here, right? But it's a mentality, right? When you decide, hey, I'm not going to work a wage slave job anymore. I'm going to be the entrepreneur of my own happiness. I'm going to be the engineer of my own life. I'm going to work under the table. I'm going to do barter. I'm not going to, you know, keep any kind of savings in bank accounts, that sort of thing. So we see that, and we can encourage that and be a part of that. So the third one, dismantling the state by localization. Now, this is something really dear to my heart, and I think such an important idea for this movement. And for those of us who have woken up and been professional activists long enough to sit and ponder all of these ideas, we have the luxury of completing this worldview and making it more thorough and more complete in terms of where we're going with this. And this is in my book. I hope everybody got a copy. By the way, I just went down to the front desk to see if they had any extras. We donated 1,000 to be put in everybody's welcome bags. And they said they were all gone, except for like 10 that were left out of 1,000. So thank you very much. I hope you all got one. If you didn't,
what do I miss that?
Freedom. All right, yes. Okay, good. So this is really important to me, this idea of localization. That if you think, you know, hey, if you don't get the message as a message of ethics and morality and philosophy, it's really tempting to think, well, socially liberal, fiscally conservative, constitution, end of the day, that's it, right? But you know something's wrong with that. Like, even the people that really believe in that, if you press them on it, you go, okay, so where is this going? Like, all right, we're going to elect someone who's socially liberal and fiscally conservative and freeze, and that's the ideal utopia state for humanity till the end of time? Like, no, I don't really buy into that. You have to see that there's a set of much larger dynamics in the course of human history that are driving us towards the inevitability of a voluntary society. Now, I could go on for hours about that, and we could debate that and get into the minutia of how this is going, but you guys see the exponential increase in technology that we're experiencing now. Moore's law, computing power doubling every 18 months, which drives productivity, life expectancy, communications technology, global connectedness. You talk about rendering the war obsolete, right? Rendering war as a concept, as a racket obsolete. Well, it requires, and I can tell you this from my experience in the Marines and deploying, a certain dehumanization of the enemy, right? It's okay to kill them because the politician said so and they're not really human anyway. You have to have that. I mean, it is one of the things you realize too, especially when you get into the actual security issues around gun rights activism, human life is really, really fragile. The fact that you are alive right now is a beautiful assertion by everybody else on the planet who could kill you very, very easily that you should be alive.
Yes.
Like, what a beautiful thing you appreciate when you see it that way. And when you can connect to people on the other side of the planet, you can talk to Iranians that the government is trying to get you to think, you know, should all be nuked. It's really hard to then go and have the same kind of force-on-force war of traditional war where millions of gullible young men are dressed up in silly costumes and marched out into the middle of the field where none of them live to kill each other because they're wearing different colors. Like in today's connected world, inconceivable, right? And yes, I know what that word means. So, thank you, good. You'll pay attention here. So, like I said, I could have talked about those things for hours on end each, but read the book. It's way better than me anyway. So, what I want to talk about, what I thought would be of more value to this audience, would be to share some of the things that I think are ideas that are unique to me and how I live that I've incorporated in my activism that have made me successful. Would you guys rather hear about that?
Yes.
Okay, good. And we'll leave time for questions, too, so we can get into whatever you guys want.
You've got a majority.
But the this is a dictatorship. I don't know what you're talking about. I'm in charge here. My name's on the door.
I'm sure a benevolent dictator will stand.
Okay.
So we're not allowed to heckle you?
Heckling is encouraged. All right, so the first thing, it's...
Is it subsidized?
What's that?
But is it subsidized?
Is it subsidized? By the LNC. So the first thing is to correct a bit of a misconception about me. A lot of people think I'm brave. They say, oh, he's a Marine. And former, thank you, I'm better now. he volunteered to go to Iraq. Oh, you know, he danced at the Jefferson Memorial and loaded a shotgun and cursed at cops and blah, 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 right? And none of it's true. Like, I'm not the stories. I mean, that was all green screen, the whole thing. Like, the cops were actors. And I'm Jonathan Brandis. Nope. Oh, okay, good. Okay. We're really paying attention to the interwebs now. Anybody know the, like, Alex Jones, Bill Hicks conspiracy?
Oh, yeah.
Right? Like, yeah. And they've got the tooth analysis. Oh, my God, their teeth are this. They did that to me. Apparently, I'm a child actor who killed him. You know, Jonathan Brandis, Neverending Story, yeah. Ladybugs.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You're better off not knowing. It's okay. My teeth matched some child actor who looked just like me, who happened to die when he was 17. Coincidences happen. It's just a coincidence. Anyways, so people think that it's about courage. And it's not. Courage is for when you're stupid. Courage is for uncertainty. And I'm saying it's a bad feature because it's an essential one to human survival. But that's not what I do. That's not how I make decisions. That's not how I plan activism. And it's a very, very important distinction. And at the end of my remarks, I want to get to something that's a little more about seeing the higher value in this. But what I do is more about calculated risk than about courage. And there are two things that I do in making these calculations that I want to share with you that I don't think most activists are capable of, or human beings in general. And a lot of what I do that people accuse me of being brave for involves getting arrested. How many people here have been arrested? Not really. How many of you have been arrested? Yeah. How many of you have been arrested more than five times? No, you haven't hit five?
No, I haven't made it four.
All right. Good for you. I think I'm working on like 40 right now. And most of them are for anti-war stuff where you protest and there's a cite and release and they arrest you and they give you a ticket. Okay, like Jefferson Dance Party. When I got arrested for that, I was in custody for 3 or 4 hours, and it was only because I refused to cooperate. Like, I would have been arrested, detained, they pull you off the site, they take you back to a booking facility, fill out your information, give you a court date, and then you're free-ish. Slightly less than you were before, right? I mean, some of you guys know what I'm talking about from having been through stuff like that with activism or without activism. And when, with the shotgun incident, I was in jail for 4 months, and I did 2 months in solitary confinement and thoroughly enjoyed my government-induced taxpayer-funded spiritual retreat.
Yes.
Calling it that never gets old. And
three meals, three hops, and a
cup. Yeah, yeah, it was great.
A gated community.
I got 4 months off from having to pay any taxes.
It was, yes.
But when people look at that cost-benefit analysis of activism, they put in, I might get arrested, right? There's like, I do this, and then I might get arrested. I mean, I'm trying to make parentheses, so it's like a really complex algebraic equation. You guys get like this page in your head, okay, good. So then there's, I might get arrested. And that's literally an X factor in the equation that could be infinity. And so what I do that's different is quantify that fear. And that's so important. And you guys can relate this to like the message of freedom in general, trying to convince people of the ideals of a stateless society. Well, what about this? Well, what about that? And it's these fears, like, oh my God, who's gonna build the roads, right?
Yeah.
We might not have roads, and I can't even imagine what would a world without roads be like? Oh my God, we're all gonna die without government, right? But when it's getting arrested, like, I mean, I can just do like the quantify, like, okay, if I'm getting, I'm going to risk getting arrested for dancing at the Jefferson Memorial. I'm very confident, like 99%+, that if I get arrested, it's going to be a cite and release kind of arrest. It's going to be a protesting arrest, right? And in that case, if you guys have seen the video and I got body slammed, the scary thing about that, and the thing is, it is true, anytime you interact with the police, your odds of dying go up a little bit, right? But you can't let that overwhelm your equation here. And it's, I mean, people look at that when I got body slammed, you know, if you notice, I tucked my chin and I slapped the floor. It's like stuff I learned in Marine Corps martial arts, like how to fall, right? Without, and the crazy thing is, like, if I wasn't a, you know, Marine Corps rugby player veteran, like, I don't know what that cop would have done, but, like, I could have died just if I just released my neck to slam my, the back of my head on the marble there, right? So, take that out of the equation, because the odds of that happening again are, like, infinitesimally small. But I knew that if I got arrested, it would be a cite and release kind of arrest. It would be an investment of a few hours of my time at most. And by not cooperating, I wasn't giving them my address and, like, you know, not just that kind of stuff. And that's why they actually held me for it was like 3 or 4 hours. Like, that was the whole thing. And it wasn't even that uncomfortable. It's kind of fun. You know, like, they put you in a new room every few minutes, and then, you know, you get your picture taken, you know, with a mugshot. They wouldn't let me smile for that. I had to remember that. That was why it took 3 or 4 hours for this one, is they wouldn't let me smile for the mugshot. And I'm in the police department, like in this Parks Police dungeon, you know, in one of the little holding processing cells. And I'm... No, you can't do that. Okay. And so, like, I actually got a picture, got them to take a picture of me going... And they sent it because they couldn't process it as Parks Police because they're federal, they want to send it to MPD. And they're like, MPD wouldn't accept your picture. You know, but anyway, so that was part of the fun of that. So it's like I get a little extra adventure. I mean, even going to jail for 4 months, just so you know, like, I could have made that a lot less. Like, I did the same thing with non-cooperation when I got arrested and my house raided and a flashbang grenade thrown in my my face, was that I refused to fingerprint, I refused to sign papers, and I actually was put in a really difficult holding cell. All right, they got their clip. All right, now we can get back off the record, right? Oh, we're still recording.
No, I'm just looking at you. Will he ever stop smiling?
So I could have cooperated in that. I could have signed the papers and given my fingerprints, and I could have taken a plea deal, and I could have been out of jail, you know, in a week or two. Probably less if I had just, like, really bent over and said, sure, whatever, I'll cooperate with everything. And part of doing that 4 months in jail was my choice, based on the strategy that I was taking in that. And if I wasn't ready for that, I wouldn't have done it. And I understand that if you're doing the cost-benefit analysis equation, if you're planning on spending a few months in jail, you know, you should account for that properly, but that is still, a finite, quantifiable cost, right? It's not an X factor. So that's really important, because if you cannot quantify your cost, what do you have to weigh against your benefit? And this is like, if you can't do this first part, the benefit side of the equation is useless. Well, I might get a video that gets millions of views. Well, I might reach millions of people with the news of this. I might actually get a law change, or like Mark, you know, I might actually get policy changed or interfere with the system. For those who don't know, Mark is an incredible activist doing jury nullification and has had some incredible run-ins in courts in Florida. Forgive me for not getting all the details precisely, but handing out pamphlets and getting arrested and challenging judges' ruling on what constitutes free speech outside a courthouse. You know, I mean, it's like, yeah! So I don't know if you had to use courage, but I would hope there was some calculated risk in there that you knew there was a huge benefit on the other side, that you might have a room full of libertarians clapping for you at some point in the future, right?
No, I didn't think I'd get arrested.
He was calculated.
Yeah, you got any kind of activism now in America today, right? You have to at least got to put some of that in the equation somewhere, right?
But at least the first time.
Oh, the first one, okay, yeah. Right. How many arrests do you have?
Let me see.
Less than
only
five?
Only two that I count.
You can count them on your hand.
Yeah, right. I'm not seasoned like you. You're my mentor.
Right. I've taught everybody how not to do it, right? So, the other side of that equation that's so important, this is kind of what I want to come back to about when you get this message philosophically, when you see it as a comprehensive worldview, when you see where this is going, the benefit side of the equation is also totally different. Now, I guess I gotta start with a little bit of a sidebar here about my concept of capitalism and wealth accumulation as a personal policy. Capitalism, I don't want to redefine it, I want to define it properly. Ownership of the means of production for the pursuit of profit. Okay, what is the ultimate means of production? Is it a factory? Is it a car? Is it a widget? Yeah, I said, right, it's you, the individual human being is the ultimate means of production. Ownership of the means of production means self-ownership. And the ultimate measure of productivity is not dollars. I mean, as soon as you realize that, like, all of these silly things that people are striving for and just bending over backwards to get, it's all measured in dollars, and you go, wait a sec, that system? That can't be right. I mean, you could abstract it properly and say, well, material wealth, whatever. But it's not dollars, it's not widgets, it's not numbers. The only legitimate measurement of productivity is human happiness.
You're correct.
And as the owner of the means of production, only you get to decide what that is, right? So, if you need so much to be happy and healthy and secure, and that might be a nice big house, that might be a successful business, that might be a pretty healthy rainy day fund, that might be college savings for your kids, although I think most of you are smart enough here to not fall into that trap, right? Whatever that is, once you have that, anything more that you take and keep for yourself, that you pile up under that, being greedy. It's not being greedy, but it is a malinvestment of resources. Because if this is what you need, and anything more than this does not contribute to your health or your happiness or your security, then anything you get more than this should be spent on other people. Whether it's as an investment in a business that's going to pay you back, it's going to provide you more long-term security, whether it's giving it away as charity to people in your community that's going to give you reputation capital, or whether it's simply doing the things to help people around you that you know are going to lead to the world conspiring to make sure that you always have this. This isn't socialism, this isn't asceticism or anything silly like this. This is a better application of capitalism. And when you get this, and you can take that attitude into your life and how you go through the world, you can put in perspective where we are going with this. People say that I'm selfless. I don't believe in altruism. I mean, it's silly. We only live in our own heads. I can't live in your heads. I mean, it'd be nice. Maybe we'll get there with technology someday, right? But altruism, serving other people, what you're really doing is serving your own vision of what the world should be. People say that I'm selfless because I'm an activist who gives of my time and things like that. I make sacrifices. Bullshit. I'm the greediest motherfucker on the planet. I want to bend the entire world to my vision and establish a stateless society because it's the world that I want to live in.
Yes.
With peace and harmony and productivity for everyone because it's going to make my life better.
That's right.
I'm serving my highest vision for what humanity can be. Now, back to the equation, right? Nice to be able to plug that in on the benefit side. But even if you don't quantify for yourself in any way that translates to something that you can apply to, am I going to do this or am I going to do that in my activism, there are so many other big things that people don't quantify. And one of them is reputation capital. We all know that idea, right? That by other people knowing you and respecting you or having some understanding of who you are, what you're capable of, that is a capital. That is something of actual value. I would rather be investing in this. Like when you have this, there's no limit to the reputation capital you can build outside of it if you see that greater investment that actually enriches not just your pile of stuff, but the world that you live in. When you see that there are other long-term benefits, that there's a joy in the activism itself. When you can see that, hey, if I gotta go to jail for a few nights, I'm gonna get to catch up on my meditation and my yoga, right? You can actually plug those things in. You can see all of the other extrinsic and intrinsic benefits that come with this kind of activism. And when I say this kind of activism, I don't want for you to think that these things are limited to you know, high profile, high risk civil disobedience stuff, because it applies just as well to do you run for office or not? Anybody here run for office yet? Yet. There's gotta be like the least number of hands in any room in this convention, right? Twice? But that's a tough decision. How many of you have considered running for office? That should really be everyone. No, seriously, if you're here, all right, right now I want you to consider running for office. Okay, now raise your hand. Good, that's everything. No, seriously though, I mean, everybody, as an avenue of activism, everybody should consider that, and a lot of people don't, and maybe the arrest risk isn't there, but there's a lot of other unquantifiable potential costs that people don't take the time to quantify from X factors down to something that they can at least subjectively wrap their heads around. Oh, well, my family might not like me. Okay, what does that actually look like? Can you quantify that? What, like, could you ask them about that? Could you do a little research and figure out? Most people just go, I'm afraid of that. And they can't actually process that properly in the equation, and it stops them from making bold decisions. It stops them from stepping out as an activist. So, I hope you guys get that idea now. So I'm not brave, I'm just better at making crazy algebraic calculations in my head.
One of the ones I've always used is driving a car, which is one of the riskiest things we do in America.
Yeah.
Is driving cars. It's very, relatively speaking to most of our other activities, it's very dangerous. So it turns out that most things we do in life are way less dangerous than driving a car, yet we never even consider the cost, and driving a car is perfectly acceptable as a risk.
Absolutely.
And yet most of the things we're likely to go do, even in activism, are in many ways less likely to be less dangerous compared to that.
Absolutely. So, I mean, there's a lot of just little statistical obvious things that you can use to compare to put this in perspective. So thank you. I mean, the government kills 40,000 people a year on American roads and highways. You know, the argument against that, well, if it wasn't for government, some of those people would die anyway. Right. So like Hitler's death count, we should at this point just dismiss because all those people would be dead by now anyway, right?
As you were talking, the reasons to do this for activism, there's one part you kind of left out, well, at least the way I think.
I wasn't trying to be comprehensive. You only have that one. Reasons for activism, come on, that's like a day-long class.
No, I think it's a responsibility of the intellectuals to expose the lies and tell the truth. That's not my quote, but since I have two grandchildren, I mean, my kids are gone, the mortgage is paid, now I can mess with them a little. And the thing is, the more intelligent you are, the more you see what they're doing.
Yeah. Well, you know? Mark, I got to address something about that that's really important. I'm not just being a contrarian. This is actually something I want to talk about today, is that idea of responsibility. I talked about this yesterday at lunch. Responsibility, duty, obligation. Where do you hear that? Republican and Democrat conventions. Not here. Because it's not about that. You don't have a responsibility or duty or an obligation. You have an opportunity. I mean, duty and obligation, responsibility only comes from some other external pressure or some obligation to some emotionally manipulative force. If you see that as a responsibility, I would hope that at some point you could at least reconsider it as, it's not a responsibility, but if I'm the person who's in a position to create this value, and if I don't do it, no one else will, well, that's a responsibility to myself, to my own higher vision, to do that. But that's not a responsibility, that's an opportunity. And what I want to get to with this, do you have a question? No, okay. What I wanted to get to with this is if it's opportunity instead of responsibility. Well, now I gotta check my notes. yes, here it is.
Why can't it be bold?
Burning out.
Why can't it be bold?
I'll tell you why. This is exactly burning out. How many of you have seen activists burn out of this movement? They come in and they leave. They come in, they go to a few meetings. They're pissed off, right? What do you see about like the personality traits of people or the engagement characteristics of people who burn out of this movement?
They're impatient.
They're impatient, absolutely. That's pretty much a universal. What else?
Demanding immediate results.
Same thing, right? Demanding immediate results.
Yeah, some are lazy.
Okay, some are lazy.
Feeling of obligation?
Yes, they have a feeling of obligation. What else?
It's work, not a joy.
Yes.
And they might have one idea, one method in mind, and they're not flexible about how other people might think it should
be. Absolutely.
So, a
crusader. It's like they have an emotional investment, right? Like, okay.
Lots of times they aren't active until something happens to them, big or a loved one. And then they say, that's it. What do I got to do?
Well, there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, a lot of us came into the movement that way, right?
I was going to say, I think a lot of people also come in and they have ideas, but they don't actually want to do anything.
Okay.
They want to tell you how to do things better.
But those people don't burn out. they're still here right now telling other people what to do.
They get frustrated because then they're like, well, I have this great idea I gave you. Why didn't you do it?
Right. Yeah, we definitely see that.
Unrealistic expectations.
Okay. There's one other thing I'm getting at here. And you guys kind of hit around this and talk about obligation, feeling that duty, right, is an important one. But what I wanted to really home in on here is that it's that reactionary, something happened to me, I'm angry. Mm-hmm. I'm upset. It's motivated by negativity. And a lot of us come into it that way. And I've been through all of those phases. I mean, you see, part of the beauty of what we're going through as a species right now is this incredible convergence, and you see these patterns in how people wake up, and the angry phase, right? It's a big part of it. Do you?
Yes. I feel like it was my generation that caused or allowed the mess that we're in right now.
And you're responsible for it.
Because my generation was the one that was underneath the as Marianne Williamson put it, you know, the American soldiers walked onto an American campus and killed American students at Kent State. And at that point, the activists said, if you want it bad enough to kill, you can have it. Because we were all young. We were, you know, I was under 18 at that point. I'm old now. Okay, I'm past that. My kids are grown, I got grandkids, but I'm old. My length of time is another 25, 30 years. But if I died tomorrow for a cause, that would not be a problem, you know? And so right now, I'm into the activist because now there is less to lose. I mean, if I die, it's not a big deal.
That's freedom.
Mm-hmm. You know? You have to have that mindset, or you are going to be afraid. And Alex Jones spreads fear.
We pull people out of that.
Yeah.
And by the way, one of the things in the book, Freedom, that I was a little apprehensive of including is chapter 9 about personal freedom. Propaganda wants you to feel a certain way. What does it mean to be immune to that? And to see that people have embraced that as a core concept to the message is really exciting. So to this, back to this idea of obligation and burning out, if you have a duty, if you have a responsibility, if you have an obligation, That's a weight on you. You notice that the angry people either grow out of it or leave. Right? There's no one here. I have not seen a single person at this convention who says, I've been an activist in the party for 20 years and I'm mad as hell. No, you grow out of that or you leave. And getting past that is how you avoid burning out. I assume that some of you here are probably new to this, but if you've been around for a while, I assume if you're here at the LNC, you at least know what I'm talking about. You're probably past this already, but I hope that by pointing this out, I can encourage you to stay with that zen, to stay away from that negativity, even if you communicate from it. Because there's times when it's really powerful, and you'll hear me give speeches where I'm channeling my old anger, or you know, I'm not. There's no such thing as perfectly zen, right? But you know, when I can bring that out and present that in a way to connect with people and share that negativity. But I don't live in that. I used to as an activist. I really used to. I mean, with Iraq Veterans Against the War, believe me. Oh yeah, I'm a veteran who was suckered and just saw my buddies die because of bullshit, and I'm just figuring that out.
Yeah,
I'm gonna be angry. You're gonna be lucky I'm not shooting politicians. You know, like when we were doing nonviolent civil disobedience, someone pointed out, like, the reason it's powerful for veterans to be doing nonviolent civil disobedience is because we're different than the granny peace brigade who sits in a, you know, on a sidewalk and blocks the cops. When we do it, it's by choice, because if we wanted to, we'd be blowing up the Capitol right now.
Exactly.
So, important distinction.
It would not be a bad thing either.
Sidetrack.
I'm just pointing out. Just saying.
Stephen Hawking, the astrophysicist, had a good comment. He said that he feels that the most destructive force out there is lack of empathy. And when I was signing petitions for medical marijuana, someone wrote by me and said, well, I'm not into that. I said, well, I'm not either, but it's for somebody else who may need it. So we don't see that as, I think the parties say, well, I'm against this because how does it affect me? But you have to look at how it affects other people, what uses might be for them.
Absolutely. All right, so, and if you can find something like that, what you're doing is you're finding a higher value on the benefit side that's not based on ego gratification or satisfying your expression for anger. All right, so the next thing, metrics of success. And this is so important to activists because a lot of it is just feel-good bullshit. You know exactly what I'm talking about. Maybe not so much in the libertarian community as in conservative or liberal activism communities, but it's still a problem here because And this is just humanity in general, that we do a lot of stuff just because we feel like it, just because it's what occurs to us now, or whatever. There's a lack of being purpose-driven and thoughtful and deliberate and knowing what your metrics of success are. And in activism, I mean, I have one metric of success, and it's we establish a voluntary society, and then I can retire. But until then, we abolish government altogether, and then I can retire. I'm going to learn how to play guitar and paint. I'll come back here, and we'll have a concert instead of this. So, and an art show, of course. The three, as I see, there are only three legitimate metrics for freedom activism. One, are you winning converts? Now, easy to quantify in the sense that you know when someone has turned that corner, right? You know when their mind is free, you know when they're thinking for themselves, you know when their worldview has been altered, right? And the trick about this is that we don't really know. You know, we don't really, like, I put out a YouTube video and it gets a million views. How many of those people were converted by that, right? Pretty tough. But I get emails every day now. For those of you that don't know, I have a YouTube channel. It's got, I've taken a lot of videos down, so it says 47 million. It's actually 53.
Oh, wow.
We're very, very careful about counting our views. One of the things that this leads me away from, that's I think very important as a principle, I would hope that the movement would consider, that people as activists who are here who care enough to listen to me for an hour at least, is that if you're making soft impressions, if you're getting people to agree with you on one little issue, and you're not taking it to the logical conclusion, again, it's like fighting inch by inch. you're going to win an argument, you're going to win a conversation, you're going to maybe even in a totally friendly, cordial conversation, find common ground with a raging statist who's going to say, okay, fine, we shouldn't put parents in jail for medicating their children. Like, hey, how about that? You know, with medicine that the state doesn't like. But does that change anything? Does that really grow the movement? Does that person is going to go back? They could change their mind just as well in the next conversation with some politician asking for their vote. Well, no, we really have to put these parents in jail because if their kids get CBD oil, then the terrorists win. Okay. So that's why if you don't have a metric in what you're doing, at least some concept in your head, even if it's subjective, even if it's impossible to actually quantify, having something that's theoretically quantifiable gives you a lot more direction and ability to evaluate the effectiveness of your activism. So the second thing is reducing the amount of coercion in society. That's an obvious one, right? Because I don't want to discourage anybody. Like, people say, you know, you hear from people in the movement, like, political participation is bad. Obviously, I don't have to, you know, worry about that in this room. But, like, I hate hearing people say, oh, yeah, if you vote, you're condemning the state, and no change was ever made through voting. Have you seen what's happened with marijuana legalization in the last couple decades? I mean, pot is so legal in America now, it's not even fun to smoke anymore. That happened because people, stoners, were willing to get off the couch and vote. Change happens this way. Get over it, right? But that is something that actually reduced the amount of coercion in society. Mark, getting a policy changed, getting a bad cop fired, getting somebody off death row. These are all very quantifiable things that we can say we reduce the coercion. Now again, how do you measure coercion? It's kind of subjective, right? I mean, obviously the ultimate application of coercion to an individual is to kill you, right? If I get a tax lowered, how do you compare that? But at least you know that you're doing something that's concrete, that you've achieved, that you can point to and get that satisfaction from, and know that your efforts are being applied to create real value for someone, and ultimately, of course, yourself. The third metric, and this should be obvious, you see a lot of people screwing it up, are you having fun?
Yes.
If you're having fun, I really don't care. If you're living well, good. If you're doing it in the name of freedom, awesome. Spread that, share that. I don't care if you're not effective in any other way. If you're getting out and having fun, that's awesome. But holy crap, there are a lot of people who screw that up, right? Just a friendly reminder. All right. So, I do want to leave a little time for questions, but we only got about 10 minutes, so I'll make this quick. The last thing is take big shots. I like to refer to my career, if I can call it that, as an activist, as having won the lottery 10 times in a row. My first action with the Iraq Veterans Against the War got me on the front page of the styles section of the Washington Post. Commentary about the uniform, I don't know, but it was the local whatever. That was for our mock combat patrol through Washington, D.C. Dancing, okay, I ran for Congress. I got, you know, endorsed by Ron Paul because I had been active supporting him. The Jefferson Dance, okay, I got a radio show. I was about to get canceled because I wouldn't sell ads. I didn't want to sell ads. I wanted to rant and tell the world how right I was about everything. Why do I want to sell radio ads? That's not what I'm in this for. I was growing pot and making a living doing that. Like, I didn't need money from the radio show. But right before I was going to get canceled, I got a call for a television show. And then I had a TV show for 4 months and got canceled for political reasons. So then, you know, during that time, Jefferson Dance Party. Oh, I'm going to dance. Oh, what do you know? I have a video that went super viral. By the way, my version of that has like 1.5 million views. There are 5 others that have over 1 million views. It was like a major national story. And by the way, because I had a TV show when other TV shows covered that, like when it was on CNN and Fox and MSNBC, there was like activists at the Jefferson Memorial. Couldn't be like Adam Kokesh. No, they couldn't give me that credit. But whatever. They had to cover it because it was such a viral video. I mean, the shotgun thing, the cursing demonstration in Middleborough, Massachusetts. I'm sort of like, you know, hitting my my, my the greatest hits, right? I've been doing this for 8.5 years straight. There's a lot of shit in between those things that you've never heard of that are totally embarrassing that I don't want to tell you about. Take those shots. If you know that this fits into a productive equation for you and you're having fun, take big shots, push those buttons, go poke at the holes, find the things that are going to break out and get you those big successes. Don't be afraid to take those shots. So, and the final thing I'll close on, and I forget where this quote is from, but maybe someone can help me out here. Despite the apparent increasing complexity of the world's problems, the answers remain embarrassingly simple. It's been said by a bunch of people a bunch of different ways, right? If I just change one word, you can quote me on it from now on. And this is true about activism. A lot of us come to conventions like this thinking that, oh, I'm gonna get the secret answer. I'm gonna go to that seminar and they're gonna tell me how to re-engineer my social networking and how to build my email list and then how to win an election. And I'm gonna get the Met because this is how we figured out libertarianism, right? There has to be a hack to this statism problem. And we think about that for our activism, but there isn't. You're already doing the right thing, just keep doing it. Have confidence in that. And a lot of us, when we've been in this for a long time, and you know, my fiance who's here, Macy, she knows that my brain is always doing this, and I'm always, am I doing the right thing? Can I be doing it better? Can I be, sometimes you just have to be like, just do it. Just keep doing it. If you're making progress, you know, just keep going. Just keep enjoying that. Don't question yourself too much. Don't let doubt stop you. And when you think that there's some great holy grail out there, I mean, it's almost a cliche to say, oh, the answers are within. But it really has to be something much simpler to this. How do we achieve a free society? We share the message with others. We wake other people up. You know, those three steps. Holy crap, I'm actually giving a speech on the topic I said I was going to. The three steps to ending statism, to ending government once and for all. Share the message, render government obsolete, and through politics, dismantle the apparatus. It's not that complicated. There's no magic solution. We get to live in this incredible moment in human history where we get to make this turning point from statism to a free society. This is what I said so many times, but I think is especially important for people like you who are committed to this cause, enough to be here and get up early on a Saturday morning to listen to me, that this moment is not an election, it's not a candidate, it's not this year or this election cycle. It is this bigger moment in human history when humanity made the turn. And we get to see this. We get to be a part of it. We get to live through it. What an incredible time to be alive. So thank you very much for being a part of this. And we have 6 minutes.
Are you plugged into the Mises Institute of Auburn, Ludwig von Mises Institute?
Plugged in the sense that I am aware of the incredible database of literature that it represents, but I'm not any more particularly involved. We can get into that later, if that's all right. You want
yeah,
to talk about
I, that? I'm very, very big on that. I sponsored the Rothbard seminar that they have each year.
Alright, we'll talk about that after for sure.
Yes.
Sorry, you were next.
What are you going to do in the future, or what are you working on now, and did you have ADD when you were a kid?
He's still a kid.
Yes, because he still does.
Yeah, right. People ask me, where did you grow up? And I say, wait a second. What makes you think I grew up?
Required as an old person, I can promise you, it's not required.
Did I have ADD as a kid?
We refused to grow up.
Yes, severely undiagnosed, and encouraged in many ways by my intellectual parents. What am I working on right now? I'm building a homestead for myself and my fiance and our future family in Arizona, an Earthship style, fully off-grid,
yes.
self-sustaining,
wow.
zero-waste home. And I think seeking that out, a lifestyle based on these values, is really essential to, I hesitate to say setting an example, but showing people at least that they can escape the expectations of a mainstream lifestyle. But what I'm working on long-term, more importantly, aside from getting people to read this book, which I wrote, I started writing in jail, as the ultimate conversion tool, the easiest way to take people from zero to I get it. For me, the next part is how we actually dismantle the state from the top down. And I'm running for president in 2020 on the platform of an abolition of the entire federal government and a return to the people of all the property that it has stolen, including the land and physical assets that it upholds, including a orderly transition of essential bureaucracies back to the state. So if anybody wants to get involved with that, I haven't really been talking about this too much publicly. I've put up a splash page at adamkokesh.com. I've reached out to my audience online and my email list. We have our forum set up at thefreedomline.com/forums. And right now people are volunteering for this. We're going to be doing another national tour in September and October. So if any of you want to help out with that, we're doing 60 stops every state in the lower 48 in 63 days. So people are signing up. We're building this network right now in this organization of state coordinators and county coordinators, the first purpose of which is to make sure that we have a successful tour, which is the exploratory tour to gauge if there's any support in this country for abolishing the federal government. Yes, thefreedomline.com. And thank you for holding up the book. And you know what I should say, for those of you that haven't snuck out early, I did bring up. Yeah, see, you'll never sneak out early on one of my talks. All right, here, you want to, can we just pass these around?
Sure.
A bag full of freedom buttons. And I have one freedom lighter who wants it. All right, so the guy who held up the book, there you go. Thank you, sir.
First, I miss your dog. I saw it at the state convention.
I do too.
Secondly, I hope he's okay. Secondly, he's Mark great. And I'm an attorney. I'm working on dismantling the court system because it's driving people into poverty. It's dismantling families. And horrendously, it's prosecuting people terribly. What is your vision, though, for, you say getting rid of the federal government as we know it, though. How do we then have some structure that we have some rules in society that we need to live by? How do you envision that?
The rule is natural law. And if you want to get more into it, that's a huge question. Can we talk about
another
this? Like, it's covered in the book. We have 2 minutes. But the short answer is that your question is based on the premise that somehow government actually creates order, that we wouldn't actually be better off without it, that it's like, people don't murder people because there's a law, you know, like that. Your question is based on that premise, and we could, you know, we could take that apart for hours.
Okay.
And I think it's good for knowing how to address that when a status throws that at you. But for those of you who have faith in humanity, the idea that somehow because of a piece of paper says you shouldn't do something bad governs your behaviors is pretty silly, right?
True. Yeah.
Okay, last one before we turn the room over.
I have faith in humanity.
All right, one more.
Do you believe the national security state is out to get us?
Is out to get us.
Do you know the national security state that Jake Kornberger talked about? I don't know.
The same way that
Obama caved on so many things when he got elected president, that he said he was going to do transparency and all sorts of things. The rumor is that what I've heard, what I speculated, is the national security state said, we're going to do it our way and keep the military industrial complex.
They took him in a room and showed him the Kennedy video.
Yeah.
Is the security state out to get us the same way that a rancher is out to get his cattle? Thank you very much.
For
the sheep.
All right, we have to let the next one.